Simon & Schuster Audio presents Eject! Eject! Escape from the Aircraft is Just the Beginning by John Nichol. Read by Thomas Judd. This book is dedicated to all those involved in the design, manufacture, and maintenance of the ejection seats, which have given so many grateful aviators and their families another chance at life. Foreword. Buckinghamshire, England. September 2022. Late summer sunshine highlights the narrow lane winding through the Buckinghamshire countryside. A few miles south, giant aircraft roar skywards from London's Heathrow Airport, holidaymakers strapped safely in their seats. At first glance, the village of Higher Denham, with its community field and recently installed play park, presents a picture postcard image of English country life. But as the lane narrows to a single track, I'm suddenly confronted by sturdy blue security gates guarding a factory entrance. An electronic sign on the wall proudly declares that, to date, the Martin Baker Aircraft Company has saved 7,681 lives. Since it was formed in 1934, Martin Baker has designed and produced over 90,000 ejection seats for 93 of the world's air forces. As I wait for my escort in the security office, I scan the thousands of names inscribed on the wall of aviators granted a second chance at life thanks to the company's incredible devices. After becoming ejectee number 6089 when I was shot down in combat during the Gulf War in 1991, my own name is on that wall, alongside those of many of my friends. A host of aircrew find themselves making this pilgrimage. My guide on this occasion is the company's business development executive, Tony Gaunt, whose previous job in the RAF gave him responsibility for the testing and maintenance of ejection seats once in service. Needless to say, all aircrew regard Tony and his fellow armourers with huge respect and gratitude. The machine shop, where giant industrial lathes and presses, some dating back to the 1940s, jostle with state-of-the-art metal cutters, is a hive of activity. I watch a porter drag an old-fashioned trolley loaded with briefcase-sized chunks of solid aluminium towards a huge computer-controlled grinder which stretches across the entire width of the factory floor. Exactly 6 hours and 17 minutes later, they will emerge as perfectly sculpted components of an ejection seat, en route to the rumble room, where the machine marks are polished out by being blasted with what look like tiny volcanic pebbles. Finally, the finished sections are fed through huge containers of chicken feed. After endless trials, the highly absorbent foodstuff was discovered to provide the best drying medium with which to conclude a process requiring substantial quantities of water. An engineer sips from a steaming mug of coffee in a nearby workshop as she studies a complex diagram. She then secures two bottle-top-sized pieces of tubing with a dab of adhesive and measures the resulting device, which will later form a minute section of an ejection initiator unit, with a micrometer. In the sewing room, portable fans cool a dozen men and women hand-stitching the dark green straps which will make up the seat and parachute harness. Their work is equally precise, and their attention to detail astonishing. Later, I watch Taj lay 45 feet of parachute and rigging lines across a giant table in the packing room. Over the next 2 days, he will fold them into a black metal headbox the size of 2 6-pint milk cartons. Taj has done the same job at Martin Baker for 35 years. "I have packed many thousands of parachutes," he says proudly. "I carry out my work as perfectly as I can, every single time. What you aircrew do up there is always on my mind." In a surreal moment, Tony Gaunt casually mentions that it is entirely possible that Taj could have packed the parachute that carried me from my burning tornado safely into the Iraqi desert, the first part of my journey into captivity as a prisoner of war. It sparks our reflections on the fact that while most ejections might be considered routine, a life saved from mortal danger in a dying aircraft, there are occasions when the ejectee's safe return to Earth marks the start of a new, sometimes perilous mission to survive. It was a theme which many of those I interviewed for this book echoed. Elsewhere, sleek, black, fully formed metal seats perch on wheeled frames at various workstations. At each one, a computer monitor guides a technician through the precise fitment of a seemingly endless series of electronic components, wires, and cables. "We all know that these seats will be in aircraft in months to come," the technician says. "They could then be flying over Northumberland in training, or Syria in combat. That's really important to all of us. I was taught to think about the person who would sit on this seat. Their life is in my hands. It's why I'm passionate about what we do here." We pop into the main headquarters to chat to John and James Martin, twin sons of the company's founder, Sir James Martin. Now in their early 80s, they are still at the helm of the family business. The walls of their office are covered with certificates and awards interspersed with signed photographs and letters from grateful flyers. A portrait of a steely-looking James Martin gazes down over the oak desk where he once worked. In pride of place on either side are industry awards signed by the late Queen Elizabeth II and her father, George VI. John rifles through a pile of paperwork to show me a letter they recently received from a 1950s ejectee expressing his ongoing thanks to the company. Pride and passion are in evidence everywhere, and back in Tony's office, surrounded by models of the many types of aircraft the seats are fitted in, he reinforces the message I'd received from those I encountered among the company's 1,200 personnel. "We have one aim here, to produce something that will hopefully never be used as intended, but if it's needed in years to come, must work exactly as designed to save someone's life." And it's not just Martin Baker saving lives across the globe. American, Chinese, and Russian companies design and produce their own ejection systems too. Taking into account the size of their respective military forces, though only limited statistics are available for obvious reasons, it might be estimated that Martin Baker's tally of 7,681 lives saved could be multiplied tenfold or more to include worldwide ejections. The man who sits as number one in Martin Baker's Ejection Hall of Fame is former Second World War bomber pilot Joe Lancaster. I had the privilege of spending time with Joe in his later years, and over ham sandwiches and mugs of tea in his sitting room, we chatted at length about his own experience of what he and his fellow flyers initially described, with the greatest skepticism, as a curious damn contraption, and, on the odd occasion, a bloody dangerous invention. When Joe Lancaster ejected in 1949 on one of the first seats produced by Martin Baker, it took around 30 seconds from pulling the handle for him to be safely under a parachute. As an aviator brought up on fully automatic ejection seats, I was staggered by Joe's description of the interminable process he went through to escape. Jettisoning his canopy, wrenching his ejection handle, blasting clear of the aircraft, waiting for the seat to stabilize, then manually unstrapping and pushing it away before finally locating and pulling his parachute release handle, all while plummeting earthwards. After my Tornado was blown apart by an enemy missile over Iraq in 1991, a mere 2.5 seconds separated my ejection initiation to automatic parachute deployment. Joe and I both had to make a conscious decision to pull that handle. Incredibly, today's aircrew benefit from a system so automated that in certain conditions it will take the decision out of the pilot's hands and auto-eject them if it considers the flyer faces mortal danger and cannot react quickly enough. But, regardless of the technological evolution of our individual seats, Joe and I, and every other member of our exclusive club, have one thing in common: a visceral understanding and appreciation of what it means to be given another chance. and the sons, daughters, and grandchildren of ejection survivors I spoke to during my writing made it abundantly clear that there are countless others who owe their lives to that remarkable invention. This book is not an exhaustive account of every aspect of the design and development of ejection seats. It is an exploration of the extraordinary journeys travelled by ejecting aviators and their loved ones. Because, more often than not, reaching for the yellow and black ejection handle is just the beginning of the story. Prologue. It will never happen to me. RAF Bitterswell, Leicestershire. Monday, the 30th of May, 1949. A day on the ground for John Oliver, Joe Lancaster, always felt laboured and unfulfilling. This May morning, he was brimming with anticipation. I was exploring the limits. There were a lot of unknowns, but I really enjoyed this aspect of experimental flying. I was the proverbial pig in whatnot. Leaving their rented house just outside Coventry, a city still scarred by the Blitz, he kissed his wife Betty and their 2-year-old son Graham goodbye. At nearby Baginton Airfield, he boarded his company's Dragon Rapide, Armstrong Whitworth's 1930s vintage 6-passenger short-haul plywood biplane, for the flight over to RAF Bitterswell. The grass runways at Baginton, Armstrong Whitworth's design, administration and production base, were not always serviceable in wet weather, so his employer had moved its test flying to the 3 all-weather concrete strips at Bitterswell, 12 miles to the east. After the short hop, the 30-year-old deputy chief test pilot strode across the tarmac, the sun warm on his face and the blustery wind rippling his jet-black hair. He reflected on how radically aircraft design had changed in his lifetime. Captivated by flying machines as a boy, Joe had sketched them and made wooden models powered by rubber bands. As a young man in the Second World War, he had flown 54 heavy bomber sorties for the RAF and won the Distinguished Flying Cross. Flying was his life, and now he was heading towards aircraft serial number TS-363, an AW-52 prototype jet, hence the large P emblazoned on its gleaming white fuselage just below the cockpit. It was hoped it might be as mold-breaking as the world's first powered aircraft, the Wright brothers' legendary Wright Flyer. Resembling a 90-foot boomerang with upstanding rudder and fins on each wingtip, the AW-52 represented aviation's biggest leap yet into the future. Its stubby, acorn-shaped fuselage measured a little over 37 feet and had no tail. Already dubbed the Flying Wing, its ancestry could be traced to 2 of the great engineers of the 19th century, William George Armstrong and Joseph Whitworth, but it boasted more than a hint of the science fiction comic creations of its pilot's youth. Incredibly, it looked remarkably like a smaller version of the iconic B-2 Spirit stealth bomber of today. Joe, callsign Raider 3, had joined the Armstrong-Whitworth test program in January, and this would be his 3rd outing in the AW-52. His first, on the 23rd of May, had lasted just over half an hour and helped him get a feel for it. His second, 2 days later, was a 45-minute sortie gradually increasing speed in readiness for today's targets. In the era before computer-aided design and the commonplace use of wind tunnels, it was down to the revered test pilots to discover firsthand how a new aircraft would actually fly. The only way to establish how these new aircraft performed, he said, was to just climb in and take them airborne. The flight test department had already given him his instructions for the day. A series of handling checks between 270 and 350 miles per hour to establish how the aircraft performed. The ultimate target was 500 miles per hour, but that would come later. Of all the aircraft he'd flown, and there were many, he believed this one, powered by 2 Rolls-Royce turbojets, was by far the most beautiful. Armstrong Whitworth, backed enthusiastically by the British government, hoped that if the testing program was successful.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.